Hello everyone, I welcome you to my YouTube channel. This is the seventh lecture relating to study of Code of Criminal Procedure. And we have started with the concept of arrest. In this video, we are going to study the procedure of making the arrest. That is, what duties are imposed upon the police officer, which he has to observe at the time of making arrest. Also, what are his powers? In turn, how much force can he use at the time of making arrest if the accused is trying to evade the arrest? Also, if the accused who has been arrested escapes from the custody, does the police officer have any power to pursue him? And what is the extent of this power? Besides this, we are also going to deal with an important constitutional question here. That is, can the accused be tied in shackles and chains? That is, can the police officer, as a right, handcuff the accused? So, this is all that we are going to deal with in this video. Stay tuned, let's proceed to the study of these topics. So, we come to procedure of making arrest. Now, before coming to the cases which are relevant in this regard, let us have a look at the bare provisions which are going to be applicable at the time of making of arrest. Now, I shall tell you what provisions are relevant in this regard. Section 46, Section 50, Section 41B. These three provisions, they shall apply at the time of making arrest. A police officer, if he is going to make an arrest, he has to comply with these three provisions. It is mandatory duty being cast upon such police officer by the law. So let us have a look at these provisions. So let us first come to section 50, because this is going to be applicable straight away when a police officer, he intends to make an arrest. See, I shall tell you what is contained in this provision. Now, whenever a police officer, he is going to make an arrest, an obligation is upon him to tell the person who is to be arrested that is this offense bailable or non-bailable. He has to tell him. If the offense is bailable, okay, the person who is going to be arrested can make arrangements for the bail, can procure sureties and securities. And once he has procured sureties and securities, section 436 shall apply. And the person who has so been arrested, he shall have the right to get released. Meaning thereby, there is a duty upon the police officer that if the offense is bailable, he has to disclose it to the person who is to be arrested. Not only the information regarding the bail, whether the offense is bailable or not, further the police officer will have to tell the person who is to be arrested the grounds of his arrest, that why is he being arrested. Okay, I can underscore the important part of this provision. Grounds for such arrest are to be communicated. Okay, entitled to be released on bail, he will have to disclose these two things. So this is a duty upon the police officer. Now, after that, we come to section 41B. All right, that he will have to show his identification. He will have to make his identity apparent to the other person. This is contained in 41B. Now, this 41B, it was inserted after the recommendation of, after the passing of D.K. Basu versus State of West Bengal case by the Supreme Court. the entire set of sections from section 41A to 41D were actually the guidelines contained in D.K. Basu versus State of West Bengal. And these guidelines have been incorporated by the parliament in form of legislation. All right. So after section 50, 41B shall be applicable. Procedure of arrest. Now in A clause, you can see identification of his name. The police officer at the time of making arrest shall bear a visible and clear identification of his name on his uniform. This is required. And secondly, he will have to make a memorandum of arrest. All right. At the time of making arrest, which has to be attested by at least one witness, and it has to be countersigned by the person who is going to be arrested. All right. So, and after that, he will also have to inform the family of the person who is being arrested that their family member is being arrested. This is also required to be done. So three duties are contained in 41B. First is he will have to bear a name of his name on his uniform, okay, which shall help in identification. Secondly, he will have to prepare a memorandum of arrest that is to be countersigned by the person to be arrested. And secondly, the arrest has to be attested on the memorandum itself by a witness. And thirdly, the family of the person who is arrested has to be informed regarding the fact of arrest. So this is what is contained in 41B. After this, section 46 is also relevant in procedure of making arrest. Under section 46, it is written that how an arrest is to be made. What is the procedure of making an arrest? All right. See how an arrest is to be made. It is written under this section that arrest is to be made by actually touching or confining the body of the person, unless he submits himself to the custody. If he is submitting himself to the custody of the police, in that event, physical touch or confinement is not necessary. Though this submission may be by words or may be by action. However, in case when a woman is to be arrested, the rules are somewhat different. There is a presumption provided in the proviso attached to subsection 1 itself. Under that presumption, it is written that whenever under section 50 an oral intimation is made to a woman about her arrest, there shall be a presumption that she has submitted to the custody. So the police officer will not physically confine or physically touch that woman, as there is going to be a presumption. However, this is a rebuttable presumption. Two things have been mentioned here which can rebut it. Unless the police officer is a female police officer. If the police officer who is going to make arrest is a female police officer, in that event, this presumption is no more there. She can straight away physically confine or touch the body. In that event, she can straight away physically confine or touch the body of that woman. And second is, though the police officer who is going to make arrest is a man, but still circumstances require, okay, unless the circumstances indicate to the contrary, circumstances itself speak that she has not submitted to the custody and arrest is necessary. In that event, even a police officer who is a man can physically arrest that woman. All right. Now, under subsection 2 and subsection 3, the force which a police officer can use while making an arrest is mentioned. See, generally, a police officer cannot use force. All right, if the person who is going to be arrested is submitting himself to the custody. However, if he tries to flee, the person who is to be arrested, if he tries to flee or makes an effort or endeavor to escape from there or to resist the arrest, in that event, the police officer may use such force as is necessary to make the arrest, as is necessary to prevent the escape. So proportional force has to be used. He cannot he cannot abuse this provision, okay, to hurt the arrested person or to even cause his death. However, subsection 3, it gives a lot of power to the police officer. All right. See, generally, whenever a police officer is going to make an arrest, he cannot cause death of the person. He cannot cause death of that person. However, if that person is accused of an offense punishable with death or life imprisonment, in that event, if that person is resisting the endeavor to arrest, okay, or trying to evade the arrest, in that event, he can cause his death while making the arrest. This does not itself give the police officer a right. This subsection really means that if a person who is accused of an offense punishable with death or life imprisonment, and such person was resisting the arrest, and in course of making arrest, if police officer does an act, okay, which causes the death of that person, in that event, the police officer shall not be liable because he was trying to make an arrest only. So this sort of construction is required to be given to this subsection. All right. Now, subsection 4 is not that much important. It is written here that whenever a woman is to be arrested after sunset, you cannot straightway go and arrest her. All right. You cannot straightway go at her home and arrest her. You have to take the permission of a judicial magistrate of first class. This is it. This can be overruled where exceptional conditions exist. Okay. So this is the procedure of making arrest, section 46, 50, 41B. Now let us come to some other important provisions under this chapter which are required to be followed. This case, Joginder Kumar versus State of UP 1994 Supreme Court. It was a landmark case because under this case, the Supreme Court first of all said that existence of power of arrest is one thing and use of that power is another. So a police officer need not mechanically make an arrest just because he has been given a power to make the arrest. Further, another thing was mentioned in this case. That was a guideline was provided in this case itself, which was later on accepted by the parliament and it was given a form of legislation. Section 50A. Section 50A applies when the accused he has been arrested and later on brought to the police station. This is a duty which is being cast upon the police officer as soon as the accused is brought to the police station. Let us have a look at Section 50A. Okay. See, I shall tell you what is contained in this. So, whenever a accused is brought to the police station, the first duty which the police officer will be having is that he shall tell the accused that he has a right to nominate a person who shall be informed of his arrest. All right. After having told him this right, he shall register or record the name as is nominated by the arrested person. This has to be recorded by him in the record. All right. And such person with who has so been nominated shall be informed about the place of arrest where the arrested person is being kept. All right. Now, a duty is also cast upon the magistrate under this subsection, under this section, that as and when the police produces the arrested person before the magistrate, all right, the magistrate shall have a duty to check whether this section has been complied by the police or not. He will have to peruse the record of the police, whether they have told him this right or not, whether they have recorded the name of the person who has been nominated by the arrested person. So there is a duty upon the magistrate too. All right, this was all for the first time laid down in Joginder Kumar's case, and later on it was incorporated in the Code of Criminal Procedure. Now there is another thing. After this, let us have a look at section 41A to 41D. We have done with 41B. Okay. 41A, notice of appearance before police officer. See, the word shall has been used in this and not me. It means there is a duty upon the police officer to follow this section if the police officer is not going to arrest. If he thinks that arrest is not necessary, then he will have to issue a notice. All right, notice has to be given to the accused person that as and when you are being called by us, you will have to appear before us for interrogation. All right, this notice is required to be given, and such person has to comply with that notice. So long he continues to comply with the notice, the police officer will not arrest him. All right, and if he violates the terms of that notice, leaves the station, leaves the town, in that event he can be arrested. All right. Or if there is change in circumstances and opinion of the police officer is this, that the accused is required to be arrested. Okay, the opinion of police officer has changed due to discovery of some material fact. In that event, he can also be arrested. 41B, we are done with this. 41C. 41C prescribes establishment of police control rooms, PCRs. Okay, now these police control rooms shall be established in every district, and it shall be having a headquarter at a state level too. All right. Now, in every such police control room which is there in the district, a notice board has to be kept outside the control rooms, in which the name of the persons who are arrested and the names of the officers who have arrested are to be written. All right, here it is written: names and addresses of the persons who are arrested and names and designation of the police officer who made the arrest are required to be displayed. And the headquarter, which is at the state level, okay, it shall from time to time collect the details about the persons arrested and nature of the offense with which they are charged, and they shall accordingly maintain a database for the information of general public. So this database is required to be made. Thereafter, we come to section 41D. All these sections were actually the guidelines given by the Supreme Court in D.K. Basu versus State of West Bengal. All right. See, when a person is arrested, he is going to be in the custody of police officer, and he shall be interrogated by that officer. Now, he will have a right to ask for a lawyer, to have some legal aid, okay, legal advice. Now, this is there, this right is there with that accused while interrogation is going on. However, this right does not exist throughout the interrogation. Now, why does this right is there? Why is this right there in the court? Why is it provided to the accused? See, this right 41D is given to make sure that the arrested person knows about his right under Article 20, Clause 3. He should know about his right that he cannot be compelled to be a witness against himself. He will be having a right of refusal to answer any incriminating question. Under Section 161, if you open Section 161, the police officer has the power to interrogate any person who he thinks is acquainted with facts and circumstances of the case. And under that section itself, he can also interrogate the accused. All right. Here it is. Okay. Now, subsection 2. This is a parliamentary clause of Article 20, Clause 3 itself. It says that such person shall be bound to answer truly all questions relating to such case put to him by such officer, other than the questions, the answers to which would have a tendency to expose him to a criminal charge or to penalty or forfeiture. So the incriminating questions are not required to be answered by the accused also. All right. So since accused is a layman, he's not aware about the law, he's not aware about his rights. That is why Section 41D was incorporated, to make him, to apprise him about this provision, about his right, where he can refuse to answer the incriminating questions. So this was all regarding 41D. All right. We are done with 42, 43 and even 44. Regarding 45, see, it is mentioned here that arrest of any person who is a member of armed forces shall not be made, okay, unless the permission of central government or the state government is obtained. If the armed forces, they are affiliated with central government, then the permission of central government has to be taken. If the armed forces are affiliated with the state government, then the permission of the state government has to be taken. Thereafter, we come to Section 47. So we come to Section 47C. What is contained in this? Whenever a police officer is going to arrest a person, if he has run away from that place and entered any house or building, the police officer can go after him. The police officer can also enter that house or building. And the owner or the occupier of that house or building will have to grant an access to the police officer. This is a duty being cast upon that owner or the occupier. And if the police officer has not been given access, then for the purpose of making any entry into that house or building, he can break any door, open any window, break any window, and can enter the house. It won't amount to trespass in that event. All right, so this is all in 47. Yes, there's one thing more mentioned here, that if a pardanishi woman or a woman who is, according to the customs, not allowed or not, she is not meant to appear in public. All right. If such a woman is there in the house, the police officer, he shall grant some time. He shall tell her to go away. Okay. She shall grant her some time. And if she does not oblige with that direction of the police officer, the police officer can thereafter enter that place. All right, this is all contained in section 47. After this, section 48. See, if the accused person, if he has escaped and he has entered some other jurisdiction, police officer can go in that jurisdiction and he can pursue the arrested person to arrest him under section 49. 49 is somewhat important. This is similar to section 46, where we read that in order to make arrest, no unnecessary force is to be used. So much of the force is required to be used as is necessary to make arrest. So this section is somewhat similar to it, and it applies at the stage of custody that once arrest is made. Section 46 applies at the time of making arrest. Now here it is written that you cannot put the arrested person in some undue restraint. All right, you cannot put in unnecessary restraint him in unnecessary restraint. You cannot cuff his legs. You cannot use shackles. You cannot use chains because this is unnecessary restraint. That is why in Prem Shankar Rao versus State, the court, Supreme Court, held that using chains, using shackles at the time of presentation or production of the accused before the magistrate is unnecessary restraint, and it violates Article 21 of that accused. All right. So what the Supreme Court said in that case? In that case, Supreme Court said that generally the police officer cannot use chains. All right. They must employ other methods, other appropriate and reasonable methods to prevent him from escape. You can increase the count of police officers who are accompanying with the accused. Okay, so these sort of methods should be employed, and even after employment of these methods, still there is some chance that accused may escape. Only in that eventuality, using chains and shackles can be done. It can be resorted to as a last method only, last resort. All right, not otherwise. Section 50, we are done with Section 50, we know it. Section 50A, also done with it. Section 51, search of arrested person. See, once up and accused is arrested, after that the police officer, he can search him. Okay, he can search him, and if he finds any weapon, section 52 shall apply, and police officer can seize such weapon. If there are some other things, for instance wallet, phone, the police officer, he shall keep those things in his custody, and he shall make it enter on a piece of paper that I have seized these things from him. Those shall be attested by some independent witness. Okay, this is necessary to be done, and that list is to be given to the accused that we have these things in our custody. After that, section 53 is important, it is highly important. We shall do the other provisions which are left in the next video. So if you like the video, if you like my content, please do subscribe, comment. Thanks for watching the video.